Welcome everybody to the grand finals of the Gigabyte Challenge number 2. We got Team Dog going to be facing up against Sharfeek's MIT. I'm not going to try and pronounce the name, but very, very excited. Best of 3 against a relatively new team versus, Team Dog. It's not like you can call them veterans. Sure, a lot of players on the team are definitely veterans of the Dota 2 scene. But them by themselves, their group, they've only been around for about a month or so. So really excited to see both of these teams in action going up against each other. And I can go ahead as we get into the draft. Welcome in my co-commentator. It's going to be Hippie. Going to be joining me on the mic once again. That caffeine's beginning to kick in. I can feel it.
Yeah, I was going to say, man, that energy level's pretty high. You just got to repeat my name over and over. I do appreciate the exposure, but I think there's more important things to talk about.
Yep, there is. There's a lot to talk about right now as we got a whole entire draft to get through. We now have the Visage, Invoker, Lycan, as well as the Nyx Assassin all being banned away. We got the Ancient Apparition as well as the Centaur being picked up by MIT. We saw the aggression of it last game. Looks like they're going to double down on it once again. Team Dog, though, running the Naga Siren, which they love to run a lot, as well as the Batrider. Batrider is really a staple of their pool so far. In response, though, MIT, they ban out some of the more defensive heroes that we would have actually expected to see them pick up. Bane, as well as the Dazzle, are taken out by MIT here. And we're also going to see Team Dog, they ban out the Tinker, as well as the Ember Spirit, knowing that the Tinker, primary pickup for MIT with their strategy right now, and of course the Ember Spirit, just a strong hero. But interesting stuff. We got the Lion grabbed by Team Dog, but it's going to be Morphling here for MIT.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of Morphling. I'll just come out and say that right now. I think that for what he needs to come online, he doesn't deliver enough. I know there are some teams that run him really, really well, but in general, I don't think he fits a lot of the time. They are against a Naga, so I think one of the reasons I think they want the Morphling here is because they have this early aggression that they obviously already are looking at with the AA and the Centaur Warrunner, but then you also have the Naga Siren, who's so good at shutting that down, preventing herself from getting killed, so they feel like they need something that can, in fact, stand up late game to that Naga Siren. And if you're just looking for standing up late game to insert hero here, Morphling is a pretty general, you know, generally useful guy on just about anyone, especially against illusion carries, quite frankly, because just stealing that illusion with Replicate is absolutely superb.
Oh, yeah. If you get a Radiance up on Naga Siren, it's not going to be that effective because Morphling's just going to turn it right around on you and pretty much give a Radiance for his team as well. So dangerous stuff, absolutely. And I really like the possibility that if Morphling is able to farm up a fast enough shotgun, can pop Naga Siren relatively easy. Maybe some of these other heroes. Now, the Lion pickup I do really like from Team Dog, though, because now they got some really heavy control and some potential burst that if Morphling does go full agi, and you never go full edgy, he could definitely be popped by that Finger of Death, even if he does have a Lincolns. You got so many that they can use to pop the Lincolns before they throw in that heavy nuke that Morphling has to play pretty careful. Now we're going to see a Lifestealer being picked up by Team Dog, while MIT, they grab the Puck. So they've got some good initiation to be able to match the Centaur follow-up. They have the Puck being able to jump in, provide a Silence Dream Coil, and then Centaur comes in with either Blink Dagger of his own or even just Stampede, allowing him himself as well as all the allies follow up with the Puck's initiation.
Yeah, one of the absolute nicest thing about having Centaur, I agree, is that it makes any other Blink initiator besides the Centaur less risky. I mean, even if you get kind of instant hexed on a Blink in or something like that against a Lion, you still have the support of your team ready to come in with that Centaur ultimate. The Lifestealer is going to be very nice. There's not really anything to deal with him at the moment, and having a secondary carry to help deal with that Morphling, because if you want to go super late, carry versus carry, one versus one, Morphling wrecks people, just hardcore. So you kind of do need a second carry to deal with him. And also, I mean, Morphling, as he's tanking up, as he's switching to strength, if he's avoiding a gank, Lifestealer is perfectly good at dealing that as well because his damage is scaling up the entire time.
Yep, this is definitely going to be really, really dangerous. Right now we have Lich being banned out by Team Dog. So I like that ban out because we already know that dual lane centaurs are kind of already dangerous when you have a defensive support up against it. You put a lich there that is that makes sure that that dual lane is not actually missing out on experience. You pull the lane back, you get a bunch of experience by denying your own creeps. It's perfect, I think, for a centaur offlane. In fact, I would love to see that more. And you don't really need a whole lot to be able to protect the Morphling at top. So, just an Ancient Apparition is going to be fine, getting some pulls, doing a little harassment here and there. I think dual lanes are going to be the best option for MIT once again, but it just goes, I mean, it depends on whether or not Team Dog pick up something really aggressive for their last support. Now, seeing the Enigma, they might just do that. MIT, they run a Morphling, Ancient Apparition, dual support in their safe lane, Enigma in the jungle, Puck is going to be your mid, and that leaves a Centaur off lane, meaning Team Dog, if they want to punish this kind of greedy support pickup, they can go an aggressive tri lane. They already have a Lifesteal and a Lion. Both of those, especially the Lifesteal, are very, very good in aggressive tri lanes. The problem is going to be that they really have to focus on picking up the support and picking off the Enigma, because Morphling is a lot harder to shut down.
I'm a little worried about that Enigma pick just because there's so many good ways to deal with that black hole. I mean, obviously, you know, you need a way to lock down the Lifestealer. You need some way to deal with some anti-BKB in case Naga does, in fact, go core. I guess, theoretically, that could still be a support Naga, but that's pretty darn uncommon these days. It'll probably be a core Naga in some way, shape, or form. Obviously, MIT thinks so as well, banning out the Enchantress. But, I mean, you have the Batrider, long-range Flame Break, to stop the Enigma. You can just have the Batrider initiate on the Enigma with the Flaming Lasso. You have both of the Lion Stuns. You can just burst him with the Finger of Death. And even when you have the Song, if you really need to panic stop a black hole from a long distance, and even once he gets up his BKB, if he doesn't catch the Naga, he just, you know, throws an ensnare on there. So I'm not sure that Enigma is ever going to get off a particularly good black hole. And while the hero can be perfectly valid getting off the occasional good black hole, if black hole is completely neutered, there could have been better picks there, I feel like. And it's greedy, too. You already have a Morphling sitting there, and the Enigma isn't going to do a lot for him in the early phase of the game, whereas Dog could be pretty aggressive with these picks they've got.
Yeah, I definitely agree. It doesn't mean, though, we're going to see an aggressive tri lane. The last pick of Crystal Maiden, you know, that is a decent tri lane hero, but for me, that signals, especially with the rise of Crystal Maiden jungle, is that we're going to see this beautiful lady. She's going to be full-time jungling, leaving the Lion, who is kind of a greedy support in his own right, to be able to get pulls and get in that early experience so you can have that faster finger of death. So starting out, they're going to be playing defensive tri lane, but I'm sure we're going to see this move into some very, very aggressive mid-game, especially if Pycat wants to go for a more late-game-oriented Naga Siren that we have seen before. Naga Siren being run mid can still farm up well, and if you're not shut down, you can turn that from a 2 to a 1 and have, especially with a Lifestealer. Lifestealer loves getting aggressive in the mid-game and doesn't really want to just sit back and farm, so they can sort of swap places and let the Naga Siren farm up in safe lane or wherever else she wants to go, and let Lifestealer combo up with some of his supports, especially that Batrider initiation, and just go full hog aggression with those four heroes and just let Naga Siren farm up. But let's go ahead and take a look at MIT. They are going to be running a safe lane Morphling. They got a mid Puck. Ancient Apparition is going to be babysitting that Morphling, and we do have Enigma going to be starting off with denying one creep at the bottom lane. So starting out, making Centaur's lane just a little bit easier to deal with, but it is going to be just that full-time Enigma jungle that we expect to see.
Yeah, I think the most frustrating matchup for Dog side is probably going to be Pycat in the mid on this Naga Siren against Charfeek on that Puck. And Naga mid can be perfectly good. Obviously, she's viable. She can get some farm. But a Puck is such a strong mid laner with such good harassment potential, both physical and magical. I think it's going to be very difficult for Pygat to get any sort of early farm. If Fogs wants to kind of sit in the lane, he's obviously got his Invis rune right now. He's thinking about going in maybe and helping out. But no, he's just going to fall back to the jungle. As you expected, that Crystal Maiden probably going to be more focused on getting experience than making any sort of lanes easier. So I feel like the Naga's going to have to play a little bit of recovery Dota when this ends up coming out. Look, Charfeek already just, you know, dodging right through the Riptide, which is Naga's best method of forcing someone with low armor right out of lane.
What do you think about this build on Centaur as well? I mean, he does have the early start, so I suppose this build is a little bit okay. He went for the fast boots build instead of the stout shield return build that we saw pretty prevalent early on. When you're dealing with harassing supports, stout shield has got to be the best way to keep your health up, and then return just gives in that little bit of extra oomph where supports don't really feel comfortable making that trade for damage, especially if stout shield procs are going off. So, you know, I kind of prefer that, but at the same time, with the Enigma denying one creep, it sort of ensures Centaur is going to get at least level 2, level 3, and can he get a stout shield in a short amount of time anyway?
I think it's good mostly because his primary threat in this lane is getting caught by a freeze from a Crystal Maiden or a stun from a lion that he couldn't get away from, that he didn't see coming. Mm-hmm. As long as he's playing very, very carefully and playing where he's going to see those stuns coming before they get to him, the boots will allow him to never get caught by those. And because open wounds range is so terrible until you have a lot of points in it, and, I mean, MSS probably not going to be going a max open wounds build, I wouldn't think, against a Centaur. I don't think it would be particularly worth it. So I think what it really does provides him more safety than he'd ever get with just a shield in return, especially because he knows that the lion needs to be off there getting his own experience, so he's probably going to be hanging out in the jungle like he is. Maybe MIT was watching the game earlier with Fog's Crystal Maiden, where they saw just how much he sat in the jungle and tried to just get experience and gold, and they were expecting that too. So expecting heavily jungling supports means that the Centaur only has to be worried when people are coming out of the trees, and with the boots, he should never get caught.
Yeah, I guess that makes a good point. When you do, especially since the fact that he was trying to get vision down, of course, it was countered right away. But if he did have that vision up, he could play really, really aggressively. He can play even like as forward as that far into the lane. And thanks to boots, he would be able to see that incoming gank and be able to get out fairly swiftly from these supports that are making the transition from jungle to lane. So I suppose there isn't as much harassment, but more just pure ganks come out of these supports. So that's a good point. Right now, Misery, he's trying to bring the lane back as much as humanly possible by double pulling and that sort of thing. Fog, though, he's pulling out the full experience, and expect them to go for a gank here very, very soon. It's getting about that time. As soon as you get level 3 on Crystal Maiden from the jungle, that's usually about the time you combo up the other support, especially since Misery, due to the jungling that's happening right now, he only did a single pull. This would be a good opportunity for them to smoke up and gank, either go behind the tier 1 tower and catch out the Centaur, or use this lane that's pushing out to try and provide as sort of a distraction while they smoke up and go middle.
Yeah, I would really like them to slow down Sharfeek and give Pycat a little more room. Although Pycat doing perfectly fine, sitting at 12-0. Obviously, the 21-2 puck is doing a whole lot better, but it's not like Pycat is getting forced out of lane. And oh, I did not see that coming.
Yeah, Smolgli goes down at the same time. The air going on the Centaur at bottom. Tries to get the stun off at the last second. Still not able to. Misery doing a really good job comboing his disables. Both times in a row, he interrupted the stomp animation. Just sort of maximizing that disable time. So really well done by him. Both of the offlaners go down. But the first blood does go the way of that ancient apparition as they were able to pick off the Batrider.
Yeah, Shafiq going to get himself a quick illusion rune up top, so just going to secure even more of an advantage in this middle lane. And I think he's going to be, obviously, we already know that he's the player we recognize on MIT. I think the both of us can say that. So I'm expecting a lot from him, and I'm expecting him to really be the star playmaker here. So him getting a good start, huge, huge, huge for MIT, because he needs to create space for that Morphling to get farmed. He needs to create space for the Centaur, who's probably going to be underfarmed now that he's gone in for, or that he's gotten picked off right there. That counter ward, I think, that you mentioned earlier was a really, really key factor in slowing down the Centaur. And they know that also that Fogged is going to be getting this good experience in gold, so they have to have the mid able to counter up these kind of extra farmed and, you know, extra leveled supports.
Oh, Sharfeek, he's going to go in for the kill on Pycat. Does throw out the last nuke, but can't quite finish up. And now Sharfeek in some trouble. Pycat wanted to get off that ensnare, but Sharfeek able to get out of vision just in time and now going to do a full heal up. So he's forced the Naga Siren back and is now going to be able to stay in lane. So even if he didn't get the kill, it's almost just as much. And now he still has to deal with the Crystal Maiden picking up the experience. So it's not like it's total lost experience for Team Dog, but it is just shutting down the Naga Siren just a little bit.
Yeah, and it's lost some, because if Fogged wasn't in here having to try and fight Sharfeek and try and get the experience here, he could just be in the jungle, continuing his little jungling rotation, which he's already doing pretty well, sitting at level 3. How's he doing for gold? He's got... Oh, all right, well, he's actually in the back of the net worth. But, you know, he's getting something, which is Better than a lot of supports, quite frankly.
Yeah, not as much as the Enigma right now, who has been able to pick up level 6 and is now going to make a rotation in with the Ancient Apparition. Not the strongest ganking support. Ancient Apparition doesn't really provide a whole lot for this Enigma, but I suppose it's just a little extra presence. As long as they don't get a little too anxious and jump on Illusion, they will be able to lock down Kabai Cat in the middle. There goes the Silence. And if necessary, there it is, Black Hole, just to ensure the kill. They don't want to take the chance of that ultimate going off from Naga Siren. Even though the Malifaux, I believe the timing of the stun should be able to keep him from being able to pop that Naga Siren ultimate, but it would have been a little bit close, especially since the Malifaux is still a little underleveled. You're not getting that far out stun. Sharpie, actually. Miss is out on a haste rune, but he's going to be fine. Misery can't really do a whole lot about him just yet.
Yeah, another thing, with that Black Hole in early ganks, just burn it. I mean, there's not going to be a team fight within the next 3 minutes that's going to require Black Hole or you're going to lose. It's not like you're suddenly going to be seeing 9 minute super aggression because your Black Hole is down. So, I mean, and that's something I think a lot of people need to focus on just a little bit more. Don't hold the Black Hole for, like, the perfect five-man Black Hole. Get it off when it's gonna not be punished for being on cooldown. And whenever you can get, you know, a couple of good kills off of it. No big deal.
Yeah, absolutely. This early on in the game, definitely worth it if you can secure a kill. Smoke League right now, he's picked up level 6, so doing slightly better than the Centaur. Though Centaur is not too far behind. Smoke League, though, it's a little expected. He can go ahead and jungle, and that's kind of the advantage of the Radiant side.
Cherry,
he can
my
go
tank
in.
Tank.
Oh, yep, we do see the rotation coming in from Fogged from behind, and he does throw a very, very aggressive ward just to be able to see any sort of those rotations. There it is. They start jumping in on him. MSS starts doing those auto attacks. We actually have a teleport coming in, though. The Puck going to try and counter this one. He's actually going to go straight for Misery right now. Meanwhile, the Centaur able to walk away. The Infest pops out from MSS. Sharfeet going for the last auto attack. Will be able to secure it, but will lose his life in the own process as MSS is able to pick up that kill. Definitely worth it, and especially if they're going to be able to pick up cherries. Fog now comes in from behind. So a 2-for-1 exchange, it was worth it already when it was a 1-for-1 as a mid for a support, but then it gets even better when they're able to pick off that Centaur.
Man, where was the tactical role on that Crystal Maiden when she was coming in for that? It's what is Fog doing, man? He's not rolling out of the trees and throwing down the Nova to get the last hits? I'm disappointed.
I had no idea. I was like, what in the holy hell is Hippie talking about? That's a free-to-play reference. You shall not pass in a little bit of trouble, but Misery, in his attempt to come in and help out the Batrider gank, is going to get caught out. He's going to get picked off. Smoke League, he's going to go down as well, as he just lost his Firefly and Centaur. Will be able to catch up to him, or at least someone will. What? To pause? He's stupid. Well, Misery, sorry, buddy. But it looks like you were going to be going down anyway. Four-man top, and MIT punish any sort of attempts of a gank by Team Dog.
It's, you know, it just happens, but you shall not pass. Picking up that early kill is a pretty big deal. I mean, he can get his Perseverance right now if he wants to, or he can save up for the ultimate orb. He's only 850 short of that. If he does want to go in for that Lincolns, you would expect he would against a Lion and a Batrider. As much as they have good ways of breaking it, they also have spells that are really, really critical to block. So I think you have to at least force them to burn one of their disables or something.
Oh.
The Lion's there.
Under attack. Pycat, he tried to use the ultimate in time to stop Sharpie from jumping out. Oh, he 2-3 times! Finally gets off that Finger of Death, but here comes the Centaur. Looking to be able to stun up Misery, trying to get close, but now the Hex, and now he realizes he's surrounded by heroes on all sides, throws down a double edge at the last second, knows he's going to go down anyway, so he burns it. Hits a little damage onto MSS. It means we're going to see a Tier 1 tower probably going down in middle, but it's going to be an exchange for the Tier 1 tower at top.
So we have actually a slight goal advantage for MIT and slight experience advantage for them too. So I think the Enigma really, despite the fact that Fogged was getting really good farm out of the jungle for himself, despite the fact that Misery was being, you know, very active in doing pulls, denying some experience to the offlaner, and despite the fact that trading pretty even on kills, that Enigma is just getting a little bit more than all of these other supports put together. So this greedy pick is actually kind of paying off for MIT. And I think when they hit kind of a mid-game stride, the Enigma very nearly has his mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very quick timing for him. Soul Ring plus mechanism is going to be out at about 10.5-11 minutes. And then the Morphling, getting perfectly good farm, as I mentioned earlier. He's already got his Perseverance. He's already got his treads at 10 minutes. So I think MIT's actually been in a pretty good shape coming out of the laning phase, but they do have to be really, really careful as Dog starts to be a little more aggressive with their rotations. The Batrider is about 700 gold to his blink, so they don't need to worry about that in the immediate future, but if he just stacks up a couple creep camps and farms those up, he'll have it at maybe 12, 13, 14 minutes. And then that combined with the Crystal Maiden and the Lion could spell doom for a lot of these MIT heroes. They have to be very, very careful about where they place their aggression because you know they want to rotate. Pycat eats that AA ultimate. Don't think he's going to go down.
No, he's going to be just fine, but they're really hoping that Charfeek was going to be able to nail him with an Illusory Orb as they started setting that up. I do think you're right, though. While MIT have come out of the laning phase just fine, Team Dog are just about to really hit their stride, and they've got just a ton of really good do shit heroes. So pretty much what it comes down to is that they've got all these heroes who can make are constantly able to fight, make small skirmishes. Bottom, though, we do have MSS being chased down. Centaur trying to get there. MSS, though, immediately throws down the Infest, but it's countered up by Apathy. He does have a black hole if he wants to try and use it here. Impale lands on two. Ancient Apparition Ultimate comes in at the right time and saves the aggression. You shall not pass. Moving forward, trying to get in those last hits. Misery wants to be able to stun up somebody here, but all of MIT, they're trying to make their way out. Morphling should be fine, so they all actually get out of what was a pretty dangerous situation. Charfeek coming in, though, can't do a whole lot as the rest of his team were very, very low. That was very, very risky, I feel, for MIT. They were trying to get a gank, but a full 5-on-5 fight without that Ancient Apparition ultimate landing like that, I think that could have been a total disaster for MIT there. Like, they in my mind, do not have the better team fight right now. Just because, like, Centaur really, really strong. But other than that, these other heroes from MIT, they don't really do a whole lot by themselves. Sure, if you get a good black hole into Centaur stun and that sort of thing, they can make amazing plays, but it's so much easier for Team Dog to execute.
I think it's definitely easier for Team Dog to execute, but I don't think that MIT has a bad lineup at all for this. Pycat is going to get picked off by that black hole, and the AA ultimate's going to fly, not going to connect with Fogged.
Charfeek, able to dodge that little impale was a nice blink.
Yeah, I think that, you know, between the Puck and the AA and the Centaur, that's three heroes who do a whole lot in the mid game, especially the Puck. That's plenty of magic damage coming out, plenty of control to hold people in for Centaur to get stomps, get the AoE double edges, land that AA ultimate. I think the big thing in that last fight wasn't necessarily that they didn't have the heroes to contest, but that I mentioned there was so much good disable coming out of Dog. That Enigma was constantly stunned. Every time there was some sort of opportunity for him to get off the black hole, he would just get stunned again and stunned and stunned. He managed to live because he managed to get the mechanism off between disables, but there was never a good chance for him to land it. Mm-hmm. And so that's their biggest problem, I feel, is not a lack of damage or a lack of follow-up or anything from the black hole, but just the insane difficulty of getting the black hole out in the first place.
Yeah, for me, though, I think the biggest problem is the fact that, like, you have to actually find a black hole to hit. You actually have to hit a good Ice Blast, and those abilities are not necessarily the easiest to be able to land. And like you said, like, Team Dog have so many disables here. It's going to be hard for the Enigma. If Ancient Apparition, like, if they're surprised from a team fight at all, like, Ancient Apparition is probably not going to be able to get off a good Ice Blast like he has so far. So if, like, Team Dog just find the initiation here, which is going to be entirely up to this Batrider, Smoke League does have his blink, and they do have the Infest online, so they do have that really strong initiation point now where they're going to be able to get aggressive, and the team fight no longer going to be set on MIT's terms.
Middle tower is under attack. Yeah, I can get behind that. Like I said, now the Batrider has Blink Dagger. I said they were going to be getting aggressive, and MIT's going to have to be really careful, and I do really think it's the Batrider. You have great follow-up from the Crystal Maiden. You have great follow-up from the Lion, the Lifestealer, from whoever needs to be there. It's all about landing those good Batrider blinks and not getting baited into a bad one right now, because without that Force Staff, you get baited into a bad Blink Lasso, you're just done. And if the Lifestealer's in, that's two heroes down.
Right now, we do have Lincoln's about to be finished up for the Morphling, so he's farming really, really well. I mean, taking a look at that CS, I was keeping up for just a little bit longer. 93 and 34, very, very impressive. This early on, are you kidding me? That's just pretty much hitting every single creep and not missing a last hit. His net worth still far ahead of the Lifestealer, who's picked up a little bit of extra gold from some kills and not going down just yet. So he's grabbed a little bit more in the kill action, but still a good 1,500 gold behind this Morphling. So You Shall Not Pass getting big very, very quickly, and it's going to make this early Lincoln's worth it. He's going to grab it about the 18, 17 minute mark, and that's going to be perfect because then he can start working towards that faster Ethereal Blade and get that shotgun really online.
Yeah, and these are a lot of very fragile heroes. Aside from the Lifestealer, who is going to be able to deal with this shotgun? Oh, here comes the Batrider.
Jumping in. They're going to bring back Sharfeek. Ice Blast is going to go down. It's not going to be able to defend him. Actually, Sharfeek gets a really good play there, trying to dodge that last bit of damage. Smoke Leak might just pop, and he will. Centaur Ultimate's going to go down, making sure those supports get out. And the open wound's completely countered from Lifestealer by that Centaur Ult.
That was some really great heads-up, calm play from Sharfeek. He said to himself, okay, they've initiated on me, I've been pulled in, there's no way I'm going to get out, but the AA ultimate has landed, I need to do as much damage as possible so they can get the turnaround kill on that Batrider. So he nuked in, he tried to go up the hill, make them chase him back that way a little bit, just slowed down the kill as much as possible, delayed it, put the damage out, and in the end, you know, Smogly, if the Batrider is dying whenever he goes in with his Blink Dagger at the start, if you kind of slow down his aggression that much, he's now 1-3. It's not like he's having a particularly great game, and if you punish every single time he goes for aggression, he's going to start playing a little more carefully, he's not going to take advantage of his Blink Dagger as much as he could, and it's going to slow down the rest of his item progression, and the less aggressive the Batrider is, the better off this Morphling and Enigma are going to be. They're going to be able to get off their last couple of big items before these engagements start, and the faster that Morph gets his Ethereal Blade, ooh. Ooh,
yeah.
Sharfeek again, maybe?
Sharfeek was trying to get really, really aggressive there on Misery due to the fact the Ice Blast hit, so he tried to blink forward, get an orb combo, but especially due to the fact that he didn't have his ultimate, he didn't quite have the damage to be able to finish off Misery, and almost got caught for it as Smuggly was almost able to get that lasso up. He's going to be working towards the four staff, almost has it. A couple of other big items are about to come online. Blink Dagger for the Enigma. That's going to be obviously a huge pickup for them. A better chance at being able to get off those really, really big black holes. Even if you do get interrupted, 1 or 2 seconds later, if you can get a good 3 or 4 man black hole, that's going to be enough time to set up the Centaur and get that really big AoE hoof stomp like you were talking about earlier. So just a small black hole, even if it's not the full duration, will be able to set up a lot for MIT to be able to combo that off of.
It's risky, though. It's really risky to go in for a Blink Dagger against this team. I mean, I know I said that they have ways of dealing with it even once he has the BKB. Obviously, if he's kind of not centered in the black hole, Batrider could theoretically lasso him, although that's not really the viable one. The most viable one is Pycats and Snare. So, yes, they have ways of shutting that down, but I would still like a BKB when you're against a Lion
and a
Crystal Maiden.
Yeah, if he goes down, the Enigma came in, pulled in that Malphus. Now he has the opportunity to throw down a black hole, and he does. Stampede going off. Apathy gonna think about trying to run away with that Stampede ultimate, but it's already down. They're not gonna be able to finish it up. Batrider being able to pick up the Enigma, and now with a smart infest, they're gonna be able to get out. Oh no, Morphling. He's still gonna get caught here. Doesn't have a waveform up in time, and he can't strength more fast enough, and he will fall. So Smogly picks up the double kill here. The rest of MIT were making their way over. Sharfeek might just thinking about popping MSS here if he can get close enough for a blink silence, but decides against it. And meaning that kill at top is going to be all for nothing as they give away the Enigma and the Morphling. Enigma didn't lose a whole lot of gold since he just picked up the blink, but that Morphling going down is a huge pickoff.
Yeah, not just that, but they used the black hole for that. And I was really questioning the choice of focusing the Lifestealer, who has both the drum and the armlet already, and Cherry might be in trouble right now.
Stunned up and now held in place. Sharfeek, though, he does get into good silence, and that's going to be enough deterrence to be able to back the Batrider up. In fact, he's actually trapped on the cliff. Ooh, Naga Siren throwing down the ultimate, just giving the Batrider enough time to be able to blink away. Wants to make sure he does not get picked off while he was trapped up there. And Centaur, in his attempt to find Batrider, will only find himself being trapped on the cliff and teleports back down to bottom where he's going to continue to farm up. And maybe even, I don't know, you think about a pipe here for the Centaur. Pipe has been an item that really fell off, but it's good on Centaurs in general. And looking at this team for Team Dog, there's so much magic damage.
Yeah, honestly, I don't totally agree with how much people are ignoring Pipe recently against a lot of these. A lot of teams have been pretty magic damage heavy recently because we're playing some very aggressive Dota. So, I mean, if you can find a hero who can farm an early pipe, it would be really nice. Against this team, obviously blocking a lot of damage from the Crystal Maiden, blocking that Firefly damage, I think it could be decent. I don't think it's as important as it could be against some other team compositions, but as you mentioned, having that magic resistance on Centaur is a big deal. Taking less damage from his own double edge is a huge deal. He can get off just that much more during any individual fight. And if you're going to get a hood anyway against a team with a decent amount of magic damage, why not just spend the extra, you know, 1600 gold, get a pipe?
Oh, Jesus, Sharfeek, he is not slowing up this aggression at all. However, it's right next to the tier 2 middle. Like, the chances are there's going to be somebody there, and it actually turned out to be three somebodies. The Lion, Lifestealer, and the Batrider all able to stop his aggression up against Fog. Fog thankfully had a little bit of stats to be able to protect himself. Ultimate's going to go down from the Centaur at bottom and get them away from this attempted gank. Where the tower, not quite deniable, so it's going to be okay. They won't lose a whole lot. Fogged, able to dodge the Ice Blast. Reinitiate, though. Centaur gets off the double. No! The stun goes out just in time, and he doesn't actually get anything off Apathy. He's going to go for it. Misses the Malefice there. Throws it on the melee creep. Misses all around. And now MIT on the retreat. Can Ancient Apparition get out in time? Frostbite not in time, as well as the stun from the Batrider. That was a beautiful... beautiful flame break, though, from Smuglig there, stopping that Centaur flame double edge. If he had gotten that double edge, Batrider would have just completely shattered under the weight of that.
Yeah, that was some pretty insane timing right there. I agree completely. So we almost have the Ethereal Blade coming out for the Morphling. He's 2,400 gold short, and at the rate he's farming, that should be the next, you know, 3 or 4 minutes. Because he's getting a lot of creep from it. It's maybe 5 minutes, maybe a little bit slower than that. But checking up on the HP of some of these support heroes. CM just has a bracer. It doesn't look like Fogged wants to go in for any more. He could if he wanted to, but he's sitting on 650 gold. So he's only got 830 life. The Batrider's not amazingly tanky, sitting at 1,000 himself. Lion is the worst off, sitting at 730, getting this very, very early shotgun. And Pycat, he's picked up his Radiance, so obviously he's in very, very good position as far as his farm goes, even though he got pressured out of lane pretty early. But at the same time, Morphling picking off that Crystal Maiden, even without the shotgun.
Yeah, I didn't even notice that Morphling was making a rotation over. Looks like he used his replicate. God, it's always that replicate that gets
you.
So
sneaky.
Yep, he just jumps in, and all of a sudden they burst down a hero so quickly. So replicate plus Sharkfeak being down there, they pop Fogged real quickly, and it looks like they're going to turn this into Roshan, as an Enigma does give you that little bit of extra physical damage, take down Roshan pretty quickly. In the meantime, though, Pycat is split pushing quite a bit and is just taking down a tier 1 tower for his efforts.
Yeah, and just quickly finishing up what I was trying to say, Pycat hasn't built any HP yet because he's going in for the Radiance. Obviously, this isn't non-standard. This is perfectly normal. Brown Boots into Radiance if you can get away with it, so you get the Radiance as quickly as possible. But that does mean he's going to be kind of weak to that shotgun if it comes out soon.
Yeah, he may need to think about just a naked Vit Booster right now as soon as he possibly can, and maybe forgo the Boots of Travel that you would normally see for a Naga Siren this early on, just to be able to make sure that, hey, the shotgun's going to be up in time. I really should think about maybe picking up a little bit of tank. But at the same time, the rate Naga Siren farms, maybe she can fill out the Boots of Travel and get an extra 1,000 gold lead over this Morphling, because right now it's 1,000 gold until shotgun, and it's 2,000 gold. Well, as I say that, it was 2,000 gold until Boots of Travel and a Vit Booster for the Naga Siren. But he already has the Boots of Travel if he wants to be able to grab them, and then it's just another 1,100 gold. I guess I'm completely wrong. You can't really shut down Naga Siren. He just farms up so quickly that Pycat, he's going to be able to have boots as well as a Vit Booster if he wants before this Morphling can finish up the shotgun and start getting aggressive.
Yeah, and on top of that, it's not just that he farms up so quickly, but he farms so safely because he doesn't have to be anywhere near it as soon as he has the Radiance. I mean, we saw it a lot in the games we were doing a couple days ago. Just the Radiance Naga grabs the illusion slip, which, and sure, she's not getting as much experience if she's pushing that way, but she gets just as much gold as she would otherwise, thanks to the power of the Radiance and the power of her, you know, pretty decent agility gain combined with her illusions.
It's still going to be dangerous, though, even once you do have a small amount of health that the Vit Booster will afford you. The power of Ice Blast plus Shotgun, the power of Ice Blast plus Puck Nukes, Centaur Stuns, general line of thought here with MIT. You get an Ancient Apparition, and you get some power, just this kind of overwhelming power to nuke down enemy heroes. Whoa! That was quite the pause there, as they just smoked up. Smoke has popped, They know an enemy hero is around, and I'm not going to make any accusations here, but I'm sure their pawns perfectly normal. Here, one of their players having technical difficulties or something like that, but it's just kind of unavoidable that somebody on the team's going to be like, hey, guys, our smoke has popped. There's somebody around. What do we want to do about this? We know it's probably the Batrider, unless there's an invis hero around, and they don't have any dust to be able to reveal that, so they're going to presume it's the Batrider. Might even... Do they actually see him right now? They might have a chance to be able to see him through this small crevice in the trees. They don't quite see him. Nope.
You checked that thing. There are pings coming out right on top of him, though.
That's true.
So they have to know approximately where he is.
Yeah, so they probably figure Batrider. I mean, this is pretty normal for Batriders. When you start approaching the Tier 1 tower, to get through this little crevice here, and you get really, really good vision of any heroes all along this line. Any heroes that you can potentially pick off, drag back, and use this cliff advantage to your side. So, MIT, they know exactly what's going on. The worst thing in the world, though, right now, would be if Cherry could actually get a kind of a blind blink on a Smugleek and get a stun off in time. But I'm sure Smugleek, as much as MIT are going to be ready for the unpause, I'm sure this Batrider will be too. And if necessary, will blink away in time.
Yeah, I expect almost an immediate blink in the opposite direction. And I mean, you have to imagine that with his flying vision, did he see that smoke get popped? I think he should have.
Yeah, I believe so. I
mean, at the very least, he's going to know that they know, et cetera. So he's probably just going to get out, play it safe. Unless he wants to be really aggressive, but I don't think he's quite that crazy. He doesn't really have the heroes in position to try and take any sort of engagement right there.
Well, small pause. Let's go over the score right now. It's 10 to 10, almost 25 minutes in. We've got almost a 3,000 gold lead for MIT. However, Team Dog, well, I say that. They did have an experience lead earlier, but looks like that has now dropped to MIT's favor as well. And now they're ready to go, and we'll see exactly how this Batrider is going to progress. Oh, look at that. Sharfeek went for the instant blink attempt to kill on Smugleek, but Smugleek did the same in his rotation out. So, pause. Whether it saved the Batrider or kept him alive, we don't quite know. But either way, Pycat's enjoying all this free farm.
150 to that shotgun. And there, he's got it. He just finished up that wave. It's going to come out to him right now. Courier already in position. He's actually teleporting bottom to try and make almost immediate use of this. He didn't quite have the mana, though. I hope somebody nearby has mana boots for him.
Well, he does have the Aegis, so if he wants to, he can just try and like waveform forward and be really, really aggressive and try and get a bunch of physical damage before he goes down. And then as he comes back, then try the shotgun combo. It's not going to be that effective, and you lose your surprise factor. But it's just options that he has available to him. I think MIT just really know they're on the clock right now against this Naga Siren Radiance, and they're not going to waste any time at all in pushing in and putting aggression on on Team Dog as soon as possible.
Yeah, I think Sharfeek has shown us that MIT is not afraid of aggression, no matter quite how deep it takes you. He himself looks like he's going for a sheep, but it's not going to be done for quite a while. He's only got the ultimate orb, so he's still sitting, about 2,800 gold short.
Yep, he's not looking too bad right now. We almost have BKB up on Batrider. What else do we got? Blink actually up on the Lion. Lifestealer, he has going to be going for an SNY. So full on early movement speed build coming out from this Lifestealer. It's kind of what you expect when you have somebody else starting to take over the hard carry role. Pycat, though, full Rat Dota. He is pushing in top and now thinking about maybe if they can force out this Morphling. More rotations coming in. Pycat, though, he pops the ultimate. And now those teleports are not going to be able to stop him in time as Boots of Travels comes into play.
I'm honestly surprised they let some of those TPs complete. I mean, you're putting yourself in a position where now you're just... I mean, maybe they were afraid that they were going to have people come in on them in bottom lane, but I think they could have just backed up a little more naturally and gotten a little bit of farm on the way instead of just kind of all surrounding the Morphling. I don't know.
I would say
you're TPing into a saw.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing, but then I thought, you know what? They really want to push down these towers. They just saved the top lane. It took a little bit of damage here, but I was thinking they're actually going to turn this into a five-man push at top because the tower was already low. So you want to make sure that Naga Siren doesn't claim one of those free towers. So I thought they were just going to five-man through top, but apparently they're actually going to go middle. And Piecat's going to have that opportunity once again. They start spreading out, though. Oh, fogged. Goodbye, buddy. Gets caught out by Sharfeek with the Dream Coil, and that means an easy pickoff for the Morphling comes in for the first shotgun of the day. However, again, we do have Piecat full on Rat Dota right now.
It's what Naga does best, man. Drop those illusions, farm the whole map, push up all the lanes.
It gets even worse once you have this Lincoln's up for Naga Siren, as well as the level 3 ultimate, so it's always going to be off cooldown, and with the Lincoln's, you kind of ensure that you'll always be able to get it off. The only hope is kind of Centaur right now, or potentially a Black Hole coming out from Enigma. Those are your two big AoE stunts, which could hold the Naga Siren in place long enough for them to get through that Lincoln's and be able to pop him. I suppose actually another one is going to be the Silence from Puck as well. But either way, this Lincoln's will be able to help out the Naga Siren quite a bit when it comes to survivability and allow her to continually split push like this aggressively.
Are we sure that's not just a Manta?
Yeah, it's a Manta. I'm sorry. I was thinking for some reason he already had Manta. Like, I just, like, full-on Radiance
is up. Really good farm if he had Manta
yeah,
right
yeah,
now.
I know. I don't know. I'm a little out of it. Smuggly, he's trying to be able to run away. Yeah, I was thinking because it goes along the line of, because I've been watching the Fnatic games of late. We had a couple games that we cast. Were you there for those, for the Fnatic Wombo combo?
I was there for Fnatic versus PR game 2.
Okay.
I was not there for game 1.
There was another one where they ran Naga Siren Wombo combos. A couple different times I've seen them do it. And Lincoln's was the item choice for Naga Siren because the ultimate was so important for them that it made sure that he always got off the ultimate. But I was thinking about that pretty much. But Manta's not finished up. So still going to be Manta. That was a herp derp moment.
Every single person in the world has those, especially casters, because we have so many more moments that we get a lot more of the herp derp ones, too. It's a volume
yep.
thing.
It's like you're trying to pay attention to so many things, and it's just like, oh, yeah, that's obviously going to be a Manta. It always is a Manta. It's always. Smuggly, go! Ooh, boy. Morphling, almost being able to pop him, and if you hit that waveform, ooh, Piecat, there goes the black hole, and here it comes! They're gonna be able to pop Piecat here, and he has nothing to be able to save himself, so he does go down, and this should mean MIT take control of the map now. Bottom, though, actually Centaur ultimate going off, but it's not going to be enough to save Sharfeek as MSS and his heavy early physical damage eats right through him. However, the line is going to be caught in the process, should go down as Double Edge cleans him up, and MSS will be able to teleport out. Still a 2-for-1. They got the Naga Siren. Again, without the puck, that's fine. They should still be able to get some map control back into their favor and maybe set up for a Tier 2 without actually losing one of their outer towers.
That would be very nice for him. That was the perfect reveal of the BKB from that Enigma. He TP'd in with the BKB running because he knew the song was running to try and get Piecat out, and just boom, Malefista canceled the TP and they just chased her down. It was absolutely beautiful. Exactly what they needed. Obviously, the BKB is going to get to the point where it won't last you through the entire Naga song, so you have to be, time it a little bit better. But for now, that is precisely what they needed out of that. And I'm totally okay with them burning the black hole for that Naga Siren at this point in the game. I think they can win team fights without it, thanks to the power of the Morphling and the shotgun.
Yep.
Because just picking off a free support, and just thanks to the other strong team fight abilities they have that are on much shorter cooldowns.
Yep, they just get the combo of Ice Blast and a shotgun, and there's pretty much there's pretty much the Lifestealer as well as the Naga who might be able to survive through that. Everyone else, well, actually, as I say that, Smuggly, he's about to pick up his BKB, so he can kind of interrupt that combo, and maybe just the Ethereal Blade goes out. Misery, oh, goodbye, buddy. Goes down real quickly. As soon as you take that Ethereal Blade to the face, you're going down. BKB popped by Enigma in his attempt to use
what?
Mech. Yeah, that was an issue. That was a really, really big issue. They're still going for the Tier 2 right now, and we do have a bit of split push going out from Piecat, but they're willing to give up this Tier 2 in exchange for just a little bit longer farm on the Naga.
Yeah, I mean, it's only because they have both the Lifestealer and the Naga am I okay with that. Mm-hmm. Because Naga versus Morphling straight up, I favor the Morphling as strong as Naga is.
Yeah, Naga does really, really spread out damage, which is good in the mid game, but you start going late, doesn't really have that concentrated damage. You know, if you're able to get all illusions on one hero, sure, it starts working, but you need some really, really good control for that. Black Hole, Kinetic Field is a good example of another ability that actually allows you to get in that illusion damage on one hero. But most part, these heroes are just going to be able to walk away from those illusions, and then all you're left is really with the Riptide Radiance, which is still strong, even going into late game, but it's not going to be able to give you a good early advantage like a Morphling will by being able to pop one hero with concentration. Single target.
Yeah. But yeah, having two heroes that you need to deal with, obviously, as well as having some perfectly good control coming out from the supports, especially from Lion, but also, of course, the Batrider and the Crystal Maiden able to give you those slows, give you those roots that are needed to try and, you know, take control of a teamfight. Shafiq's scouting around with an invis, by the way. I don't think he's going to find anything, but you never know when Shafiq is going to go in. It could be any time.
Yeah, seriously, this guy has been so aggressive all day long. He did see a bit of the rotation into the enemy jungle, which actually gave Cherry that slight heads up to be, hey, man, be ready to blink dagger away. So the moment he saw that Batrider.
So he wants to go in with Lifestealer in him.
Oh, yeah, I could see that right now. Misery sitting on the side. Roshan's going down. It's going to go down pretty quickly here if Morphling can stop taking some damage. He's going to be able to go full agility if he needs to and just start beating through the Roshan's health. However, here comes the Naga Siren Illusions, and that spoils everything. And Naga Ultimate could be going off anytime. Centaur Ultimate going down. They just want to get themselves out of the pit as soon as humanly possible. And now Morphling going to jump to his illusion, make his way out, but they're going to try and get aggressive here. Smoke Leak actually turns around here because they actually found out both the heroes. A shift, going to be able to buy Sharfeek enough time. However, the Centaur still gets picked off. Sharfeek going to have to get away from some of this damage. Smogly, he's going to go down in the middle thanks to the Morphling. Gets a little too overly aggressive there. Puck Sharfeek, he jumped to his orb earlier because he kind of had to. And because of that, is cleaned up by the Crystal Maiden and her ultimate. Now they're still going to keep going, but teleports away. MIT should be able to get out of here and actually control the Roche bit enough.
He's sending his replicate in right now. Yup, he's going in.
Yeah, he kind of needs to be ready to jump in because they can't just give up a free Roshan. However, I think with like the Black Hole ready to go, the fact that Enigma still survived, plus you still have the Ice Blast as well from Ancient Apparition, like just those two ultimates by themselves are such big like Roshan team fight killers that it's just like too risky to try and go in for Roche, even if it is at half health for Team Dog.
Yeah, but at the same time, you know, MIT isn't willing to go back in right after that because they know that the Naga Siren ultimate is up still. Mm-hmm. That didn't have to get used, and they know she is quite nearby. And that Radiance burn during that fight was so significant. I mean, even though it's kind of late for Radiance to be the dominating factor in a team fight, it drug on so long, the illusions were in there for so long, you could really see those supports starting to suffer under that Radiance power. It looks like, you know, MIT not ready to give this up, even though they are being scouted by these illusions.
Yep, still going to go for it here. Pycatch is using his vision to look for the perfect opportunity to initiate with his ultimate. He's completely letting them just tank the damage right now from Radiance and wasting their time. There goes the ultimate, though. Centaur, he already pops his ultimate, and it's going to be completely wasted as Naga Siren just kind of sitting back, says, go ahead, you wasted so much time. Batrider does actually pull the Centaur on top of the cliff. However, he's going to get bursted down for his trouble as the puck does get in that last auto attack. Now ensnared, nice dodge by Sharfeek, and they're being able beginning to make their way out. However, MSS as well as Misery make the jump in on the Ancient Apparition. So not Ice Blast is going to be found just yet. Very, very spread out team fight, but I do like the initiation there from Misery as well as MSS using the what did Sharfeek just do? Now getting caught out using Phase Shift, blinks away just in time before anything can go down. There's a lot of AoE abilities that could have caught him out. Still, MSS catches up, trying to get away. Oh, the bash into Ice Frostbite into the ultimate coming out from Misery. Combos him down, meaning he cannot jump to his orb. And finally, MIT, they get severely punished for trying Roshan again. And they should be able to clean it up. Team Dog, I see nothing to really stop them. But as I say that, heroes are actually already coming back up online. And Puck has actually bought back Team Dog. As long as they back away here, this is a huge win for them.
Absolutely. And they already got the buyback on the Enigma. So they got two buybacks out of this. They got a bunch more kills. I think the only person they lost in the end was Smokalik, right? Did anyone else go down? Did I just miss it? It was like a 1-for-4 in the end with two buybacks. That's huge. Mm-hmm. Oh, look. MIT is still not ready to give this up, but the Naga ultimate is back up. They can't take this right now.
Yeah, seriously. I mean, these guys are just being punished for it over and over again, and it seems like they just never learn. Now, they are doing a little bit better spacing right now. I like the fact that Morphling is the only one in the Roche pit, and he's using his lifesteal to his advantage, but there's still the possibility of a Naga Siren using that ultimate to steal Roche. It's a big problem. They're going to go for it right now, 1,400 health. There goes. The ultimate goes out. Not going to catch him out in time. The Apathy, he's actually kind of baited this one, but he's not going to get in. A great black hole only on one hero. Pycat, if they could burst him down, yeah, they got him. Ice Blast even coming in. Go, Dream Cup. Coil goes down, holding in three heroes over. Look at MSS. He's just going crazy right now. Buyback coming out from the Naga Siren, trying to make her way back into the team fight as MSS makes his way out. Centaur, the attempt at a stun, not going to quite make it. As this Fog uses a beautiful ultimate, here comes the Naga Siren from behind. Going to be able to catch out Apathy. Meanwhile, team fight rages on. Smuglig doing a good amount of damage with his fire, and every single one of MIT getting low. Aegis does go the way of the Morphling, who's going to be able to come back right into this fight. However, the rest of his allies are completely dead, and now he might be too. Has to be able to wait for him away. The rest of Team Dog want to be able to finish off MIT. If they can get every single one of them, this will be huge. Morphling taking so much damage, and the disables proved to be just way too much for him to deal with, and an ultra kill goes the way of Pycat. Definitely worth the buyback.
100%, man. I mean, even with, they got another really great catch out with that Enigma, and that's twice this game. They managed to catch Pycat with that, but that was a time, you know, I said the other time I was okay with them using the black hole on just Pycat, and Dog knew. They said, okay, the only way they're really going to kill Pycat is if they burn this black hole. We'll just buy him back, TP him back in, and we'll win the fight anyway. They knew exactly how that was going to go. And they knew that if they didn't, if there was no black hole onto Pycat, then it was a waste of BKB from Enigma, and they just engaged and won the fight anyway. Just overall, I think the decision-making from Dog and Crystal Maiden getting just blown apart right there. I think the decision-making from Dog during that fight was exceptional.
Yeah, I think that the Team Dog right now, you know, you could talk all you want about heroes and everything else, but I really feel the Team Dog are just kind of outplaying MIT. Or rather, MIT just kind of outplaying themselves, trying to go for Roshan three times in a row, and all three times they pretty much failed. This time they did get Roshan, but at what cost? I mean, they lost a team fight immediately afterwards, and now no longer have that Aegis advantage that they're hoping to be able to use to allow Morphling to sort of aggressively suicide in, kill a hero, maybe even do a good amount of damage to a second one before he goes down, and then you have the follow-up. Like, it's a very, very easy team fight if you have the Aegis and if you're already set up 5v5 to go in.
Yeah, and honestly, the Manta on the Morphling, I might have actually liked that to be a butterfly, because there's so much physical damage coming out right now from Dog, especially with, you know, the early aggressive build from Lifestealer, where he's just getting in your face. Being able to dodge all of those Naga illusions, the damage coming out, sure, you'd be a little less tanky against things like the Lion nukes, like the Crystal Maiden nukes, but that was the point of the Lincolns. You were tanking up, you were making yourself harder to burst down with spells, and oh, so unfortunate, that aggression just being immediately stymied by the Naga ultimate.
Yeah, Pycat got a real twitchy finger there, was ready, he knew. He's like, okay, I'm not tanky enough right now. I need to be able to pop the ultimate pretty much at the first sight of the Morphling, because if he's able to actually do his combo to me, I may get so low that one, well, actually, jeez.
He's got his heart now, man.
Yeah, I didn't even notice he picked up his heart.
I didn't see it until just then either. I was like, yeah, I don't think he is that tanky. And I was like, oh, no, he's got heart. He's good.
Yeah, that was a big difference from him him going down at that Roshan pit, getting pretty much bursted out, like one shot. Like, there was very, very little other damage happening. It was just the Morphling. From him going down there, buying back, picking up all those kills, and then now picking up a full-on heart. So much extra survivability. So he will be able to survive it, but still, at the same time, is it worth it? They pop the Morphling shield, and now they're going to be able to jump in. Centaur counter-initiates, though. Good black hole, though, holding in two, but immediately the ensnare pops it. Going to be able to stop that one, and MSS is just going to town right now on these supports. Cybernet's going to go down. Apathy potentially might go down as well, as Morphling is in the middle of the base trying to teleport away. Will not be able to get out as Pycat finishes him off. And it's going to be just Sharfeek as well as the Enigma back away, and a full-out GG call. They lose too many team fights in a row. And MIT, they say, you know what, we're done with this. It's a best of three. Let's just go on to game two and forget about the mistakes we made here today.
Yeah, I think you were really hitting on it. Kind of the key moment was definitely when they just kept going back into Roshan. I think that you needed to get that pick off, and you have a shotgun Morphling. You can get a pick off on someone key who isn't the Naga. I mean, if you pick off someone like the Batrider before that engagement starts, that's huge. Mm-hmm. You know, stick around the Rosh pit, but don't commit yourself to doing all the damage for dogs so they can just, you know, use the song to force you to burn off way more than you want to stop the Naga steal.
All right, guys. Well, that's not going to be it. We do have one, potentially two more games coming up. The finals for the Gigabyte Challenge number two is a best of three. So Team Dog, one game up right now, but we'll see whether or not Sharpie can lead MIT to victory going into game two. Short commercial and music break, and we'll be back.